Hello and welcome to Commonwealth Politics. My name is Mike Krasanik.
And I'm Mark Kemper.
One of the emerging issues here in Massachusetts and indeed throughout the United States is energy and the environmental public policies. In Massachusetts, thankfully, we are taking the lead with a number of pieces of legislation, including the Green Communities Act that the governor signed in 2008. But that's just one of many energy policy initiatives. And to help us sort through all of these laws and their impact on Massachusetts and on your daily life, we're pleased to have Senator Marc Pacheco from Taunton. Senator? Welcome.
Thank you very much, Mike. It's a pleasure to be here on Commonwealth Politics with you and Mark and to talk about the initiatives that we have put through over the last several years in the Massachusetts legislature to try to head us in a clean economy direction.
I know you've mentioned that there are a number of these initiatives, so why don't you just enlighten us about what's out there that is moving us in the direction of making us less energy more energy efficient and less dependent on foreign sources of our energy.
Foreign sources of energy, and also to try to have a lot of our energy sources be derived right here in Massachusetts. Right now, we spend close to $22 billion a year in acquiring the energy we need to work, live, and play here in Massachusetts, and over 80% of that energy is the end result of that energy, the profit, if you will, of that energy goes out of state, goes either to another state or other countries, and some countries that may not like us all that much, right? Mm-hmm. And so the goal was to not only try to lower our energy costs ultimately, but try to transition to an economy that has a clean energy future, where we can generate most of our energy here in Massachusetts, that we could save not only some money in doing it, but also clean up our environment as well, and cut back on the number of CO2 emissions that we emit as a society. But also look at ways in which we could green up the bottom line. Mm-hmm. And so we embarked upon a program working with the executive and legislative branch together to develop a number of pieces of legislation, one of which is the Green Communities Act, which you referenced that the governor signed, which does a number of things. It's a quite complicated piece of legislation because it involves really changing the Rubik's Cube just a little bit relative to how energy policy in the Commonwealth works. And we incentivized bringing on renewable energy technologies like wind and solar, geothermal, etc. We have really tried to emphasize energy efficiency because the least costly kilowatt hour is the one that you don't have to pay for at all, the one that you don't use. And so we have really put these types of strategies in a bill called the Green Communities Act to try to get our utilities to play a role. That's also where we have worked with our New England states with the greenhouse, REGI agreement, the Regional Greenhouse mm-hmm. Gas Initiative, to cut back on CO2 emissions from our utilities within New England. Mm-hmm. We also adopted legislation, which I was proud to author, called the Global Warming Solutions Act, which cuts back on CO2 emissions. It gives the Secretary of Energy and the Environment the ability to actually go in and regulate CO2 emissions. And our goal is to take CO2 emissions and bring them down below the 1990 levels to get up to 25% below the 1990 levels by 2020 and 80% below the 1990 levels by 2050. And, of course, a lot of that is with the existing built environment that we have in our society and trying to incentivize ways to use energy efficiency to bring down the use of energy in the first place and thereby cutting back on CO2 emissions. Mm-hmm. We also have a number of other pieces of legislation that we have passed, like the Green Jobs Bill, in other words, ways in which we can incentivize and get training out there for these new jobs that will be created in this sector. Also, a biofuels bill, looking at other types of fuel sources that we will be experimenting with in the future, and not the least of which is is looking at non-food-based products to be able to fuel our transportation uses, etc. And we've even passed legislation called the Ocean Management Bill, which looks at, because there's a lot of technologies on the horizon and we're experimenting with now that deal with things like ocean wave energy. And certainly, none of us are any strangers any longer to the term of these windmills and the turbines that would be out in the ocean. But we wanted to make sure we treated our oceans similar to what we do with our land base, to actually zone where the right place would be to begin to look at places where we could utilize these types of technology, and also to identify where they should not go.
I see.
So it would not impact our ocean management, not impact our fisheries in a negative way, and not impact other marine life. So we want to make sure we continue to have a healthy marine life off the coast of Massachusetts, but to the extent that we can, safely and efficiently utilize some of that area, we want to be able to do so in a thoughtful way to help green up our economy.
Mm-hmm. Senator, let's start off with a broad question, because a number of people critique the government's actions in a number of these areas with the Green Communities Act and some of the other policies that the government has engaged in by arguing that the significant subsidies, either in the form of direct cash subsidies or in some type of tax rebate or tax break, that these are inappropriate things for the government to be doing, that the government's trying to pick and choose winners in the market, and that the more appropriate thing would be to just let the market settle this. As oil prices go up, there will now be an incentive for the private sector market to be doing a lot of these green energy type things, develop renewable energy. Right now it's not cost effective, but if the price of oil and continues to increase, and we see $200-$300 barrel a day oil, that suddenly the market will be doing these things, and it'll be naturally led by the market as opposed to the state and the government. How would you respond to that kind of criticism?
Well, I'd first of all say I'd be pleased to see the government get out of the business of subsidizing big oil and big gas and the fossil fuel industry, and we do that with a significant amount of taxpayers' dollars that go into subsidizing not only the research but distribution and operation of many of the facilities in our country.
The national government, not the state of Massachusetts.
That's right. The national government does that. So it's still taxpayers' dollars that are being invested in this area.
But I think the free marketer would critique that as well and say that that's inappropriate also. So mm-hmm. just to be fair to the free market position here.
Yes. But the free market position, I'm a big free market person, but I think that we do need regulations to take a look and see what is going to impact us, how different policies are impacting our society. For example, our public health, our national security. These types of issues have something to say, I would hope, in how we make our decisions. And that's why we can still have a future with some incentives to begin a transition to a new economy where the free market will rule in that sector. It does now with solar and wind. Those companies that are competing against one another for that sector of the business. So I think we are in a transition period right now, very similar to a transition period that we were in the middle of the Industrial Revolution, heading into the technology revolution of our time. We now are in a position where we're going to a clean energy economy. Our national government hasn't made a decision on this yet, at least collectively, all together embracing a move to that direction. But we have here in Massachusetts, and for all of those naysayers that would have said, or did say, that Massachusetts is going to move in this direction, it's going to hurt our economy, we're not going to be competitive, you know, how could this happen? We're picking winners and losers. What do we have a few years later? Our economy is doing better than most in the United States of America. We're one of the lower unemployment economies in the state. We are creating a whole new economy here in our state with our energy investment. As a matter of fact, if we look at what we have done here in our state, we've seen from some of the recent reports that are out where we have created close to 5,000 clean energy firms. These are companies here in Massachusetts that have hired close to 65,000 clean energy workers in our state. And this clean energy represents close to 1.5% of the total employment of state government here in Massachusetts today. And this is just with, you know, 3-4 years worth of investment that has taken place here in Massachusetts. The clean energy employment grew by 6.7%, you know, much faster than the overall 1% growth among all other industries here in our state. And during the same period of time, we saved ratepayers of energy in general about $1.4 billion by 2015. Ratepayers would have saved that amount of money. The benefits, $2.5 billion, are 2.5 times greater than the $1.1 billion cost, you know, by 2015. So, yes, we're investing in this new economy, but we're gaining significantly by doing so. Mm-hmm. And we're picking up a whole different market that those states that are not investing in these areas, we're becoming the leader in these markets. And this is a market that is not only a market for here in Massachusetts, but there are other areas around the world where Massachusetts companies and firms that are learning these new technologies are able to export their products and their ideas so that they can create jobs here at home while expanding opportunities all around the world.
Well, I know one of the critics recently has been Attorney General Martha Coakley, and she testified before the legislature. Mm-hmm. And I believe her argument was that over the next 4 years, energy rates are going to increase by 7%, and that's going to have a detrimental impact on businesses deciding to locate or to stay in the Commonwealth. Are her figures off, or is she not computing things correctly?
Well, I think her figures were correct based upon she was using the cost side of the equation, but there was about $9 billion that was not projected in terms of the benefits. So if you're only using the cost side of the argument and you don't include the benefit side of the argument, then obviously your net is not going to be accurate. So I'm not saying what she said was incorrect. It wasn't. What she was saying was correct. But when you add the benefits that will accrue, these jobs that we're talking about, the increase, that in fact the net, and I brought it with me because I anticipated that this might be a question, the net benefit to the ratepayer will be 0.047 cents per kilowatt hour by 2015. So when you measure it out over a period of years, that investment will pay off, and that's what we have seen thus far. And you know how you can really tell this to be true and what this is happening is it's attracting. What we've done here in Massachusetts is actually attracting the investors. The investors used to be situated mostly in California. I'm talking about the venture capital investors, looking at new technologies in general. And then we see what's happened here in Massachusetts. Venture capital investment in Massachusetts in clean tech is increased to $2.5 billion just since 2005. $2.5 billion since 2005. That's a significant amount of investment that has gone into our state. $1.9 billion invested since 2008. That's, again, right when we had the beginning of our recession that hit us, right? So even during that period of time, people could see the future, what's going to take place here in terms of greening up the bottom line. Mass clean energy sector is second now only to California, which, as we know, is California, some would say, is probably close to the sixth largest economy in the world, in terms of a state. We're doing quite well.
Senator, you hear a great deal about alternative energy, and when people talk about it, they talk about wind turbines or those mm-hmm. big solar panels that people have to put on the roofs. What is the future of wind turbines, and is there any way that people can bring solar power to their homes rather than put those huge grids on the back of the south-facing roof? Is there new technology that will make it easier for people to save on their energy bills, whether it's through wind power or solar? What's out there?
Well, first and foremost, I would urge everyone, especially those that are watching this at home, to take advantage of the opportunity that you have right now to call your electric company and ask them to do an energy audit at your home. If you haven't had one done, please do one, not to satisfy me or the state, but yourself in terms of greening up your own bottom line at home.
And they're free.
They're free. And so you can get the energy audits done, and you probably can get some assistance once you get the facts and figures on your home. You can probably get some assistance possibly for, improving the technology within your own home or just energy efficiency like insulation and other things, changing lights. That will ultimately save you, a lot of money monthly and obviously, yearly in your energy bill. So number one is energy efficiency. And because we have done such a great job here in Massachusetts on energy efficiency, we are now number one. We have surpassed California and all other states in the United States with our work in energy efficiency. Mm-hmm. Then you come into some of the renewables like solar. Those that have a home with a southern exposure, there's an opportunity to do solar, in particular for hot water. Mm-hmm. It's a quite reasonable alternative today as opposed to, say, 10 years ago, and it's becoming even that much more efficient and affordable for homeowners to do it, in particular with the hot water type of technology. Wind is a little bit is much more competitive in terms of competing against other options in the grid, like oil or gas and other types of energy. But obviously, wind energy can only work where there is wind. Those types of things need to be tested. In the southern part of my district, right on the edge of my district, Mass Maritime, for example, has just put up a wind turbine there. They've done very well with the turbine, and it saved them a lot of money. I was just at a press conference over the last about a month ago when this show airs, with the governor at a company in Fall River called Lightermere. It's a Phillips company, Phillips being the company that makes light bulbs, and they're into a whole lot of a technology. They employ thousands of people here in southeastern Massachusetts. And they just put in a new wind turbine right off of the highway on 24. You'd be able to see it as you're going into Fall River. And that wind turbine will be saving them, I think they estimate, something like 60% of their energy costs to utilize their facility in Fall River. That's significant for a company.
And you mentioned about some farms in your district as
well. A lot of farms. A lot of farms in my district are farmers are now utilizing a lot of solar technology. Obviously, they have land base where solar may work. There are some incentives available through the Department of Agriculture and through our Green Communities Act and other products that are out there to try to subsidize these technologies. And I would think the farmers would say that for those market-based critics, that it is this type of incentive has assisted them in being able to stay as in the business of farming, you know. And so, yeah, we are putting forth some subsidies in these areas, but it's with a broader overall public purpose.
Before the show, you had mentioned some net zero homes that had recently been built in the Commonwealth. What's your sense on when is that going to be the standard? And perhaps, you know, there may be a day when the state mandates that any new home construction has to be net zero.
Actually,
your thoughts on that?
Yeah, I think we're going to see a significant move in that direction. As part of the Global Warming Solutions Act that passed, one of the standards was to move to a standard in place better building. Standards that would be more comparable to what is actually done in Europe now and is done in a lot of states that had increased the standard in terms of building code. And I think you will see a lot more of that taking place. For example, we don't have it in place today, although some cities and towns are beginning to look at this as their own standard, because the state standard is a minimum code, and it doesn't mean that it doesn't prohibit cities and towns from going above that code and starting to put in, for example, an alternative for gray water, so that people that are using water products or say water from the shower that's draining out, it goes into a different section, and it can be used maybe for other types of rainwater that comes down from the gutters, and that's collected, and that is used for other types of gray water use in the home or at a company. It's a way for us to recycle. And save money. So these standards are being put in place, and there's a home that I would have visited for the taping. I haven't visited it yet, but I will be visiting in Newton, and there is net zero home. It's not going to cost the homeowner any money at all for their energy.
Talking to your constituents, do you get the sense that people are starting to catch on to this now in terms of the savings that they can acquire by having the audit or by changing their light bulbs or by putting in solar? I mean, is it starting to perk up a little bit, percolate up? That this is really something that's going to be at the top of the policy priority.
While. Absolutely. When people talk to me about this issue, it's not so much. I mean, I sort of get into the political speak sometime on climate change and those types of issues, but I find people are talking about the same issue, but in a different way. They're talking about greening up the bottom line. If there are products out there, if there are ways that they can save some money and do good, they want to participate in it because it saves them some money, which we all can. I think of that Jimmy Fallon commercial that's on TV all the time about saving money.
Saving money.
Who doesn't want to save money? And it's true. Who wouldn't want to save money? It's a great thing to do. But you're saving money and also not only greening up the bottom line, but you're helping your society in general. Because issues like climate change are not just an environmental issue. It's a public health issue. It's a national security issue. It's an economic development issue. We can create jobs, as we have done here in Massachusetts. We can actually lower rates, as we've done here in Massachusetts. And we can actually create a whole new future for our state that is not only good for all of us here in Massachusetts, but we can actually create jobs here at home and take this technology and deploy it all over the world.
So in 10 years, do you expect the government basically to be able to just exit the field because the transition will have occurred and these companies will now be in place and competitive? Or what's your timeline on that in terms of the government's involvement here?
Well, I'm not good with the crystal ball. But I suspect a 10-year period, based upon what I've seen happen, you're probably right on there, because there's so much happening so quickly in these fields. It's just amazing. When I look back with technology to some 30 years ago, when you would need a computer the size of the studio to get the computing capacity that I have right here in a BlackBerry today. It's amazing where we've come with technology, and that's exactly what's happening with energy technology and the grid. It's a matter of the political will at the national level as well. I think right now there's a great debate going on in this country. What direction do we want to head in? Do we really want to take this challenge on? Because a lot of the national grid that we have that bring our energy to our homes today was built in another generation. There was a commitment that was made at the national level to do that. Now we need a new smart grid in the country. That's something that Massachusetts can participate. But we really need the participation of all the other states and our national government to invest in our collective future. And that's the big political debate that's going on right now. If we do that, embrace it, and if we really want to head in that direction, we'll continue to be the greatest power on Earth, and we'll embrace a whole new clean energy future.
Senator Marc Pacheco from Taunton, we want to thank you for enlightening us about energy policy and the alternatives that are out there for us and giving us a pretty positive view of the future.
Absolutely.
This is Mike Krzanek saying thanks for watching Commonwealth Politics.
See you next time.